Krishna Krishnaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Nama
Govinda Madhi Purusham Tamaham Bhajam.
sundaram achintya gunaswarupam govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami ramadi murti shukalani yamena tishtam nana avatara magaro bhuvaneshu kintu krishna svayam samabhavat paramah kumanyo govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami yasya prabha prabhavato jagadanna koti Vasesha Vasudhadi Vibhuti Bhinnam Tad Brahma Nishkalam Anantam Ashesha Bhutam Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Maya Hiyasya Jagadanda Shatani Sute Traigunya Tad Vishaya Veda Vitaya Mana Sattva Valambi Parasattva Vishuddha Sattvam Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Ananda Chinmaya Rasatmataya Manasu Yah Praninam Pratipalam Smaratamukhetya Veenayitena Bhuvanani Jayatya Dashram Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Goloka Namiti Janamita Lechatasya Devi Mahesha Haridana Suteshu Teshu Kete Prabhavani Chaya Vihitascha Yena Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami Srishti Sthiti Pralaya Sadhana Shakti Reka
Brahma Yagesha Jagadanda Vidana
గోవిందమాలి పురుషం తమహం భజామి అగ్నిర్మహీ గగణమంబు మరుద్దిశశ్చ కాలస్తథాత్మమనసీతి జగత్త్రయాని యస్మాద్భవంతి విభవంతి విశంతి యంచ గోవిందమాది పురుషం తమహం భజామి యచ్చక్షురేవ సవితా సకల గ్రహాణాం రాజా సమస్త సురమూర్తి విశేష తేజః యస్యాజ్ఞయా భ్రమతి సంభృత కాల చక్రో గోవిందమాది పురుషం తమహం భజామి ధర్మోత పాప నిజయ శ్రుతయస్తపాంసి బ్రహ్మాది కీట పతగావదయశ్చ జీవాః యద్దత్త మాత్ర విభవః ప్రకట ప్రభావః గోవిందమాది పురుషం తమహం భజామి యస్వింద్రగోపమతవేంద్రమహోస్వకర్మాజనమాతనోతి కర్మాణి నిర్దహతి కింతు చ భక్తి భాజా గోవిందమాది పురుషం భజామి యం క్రోధ కామ సహజ ప్రణయాది భీతి వాత్సల్య మోహ గురు కౌరవ సేవ్య భావైః సంచింత్య తస్య సదృశం తను మాపురేతే గోవిందమాది పురుషం తమహం భజామి శ్రియ కాంతా కాంతా పరమ పురుష కల్పతరో దుమా భూమిశ్చింతామణిగణ మహీతోయమృతం కథాగానం నాట్యం గమనమపి వంశి ప్రియసఖీ చిదానందం జ్యోతిః పరమమపి తత్ ఆస్వాద్యమపి చ స యత్ర క్షీరోక్తి శ్రవతి సూర సురభి యశ్చ సుమహాన్ నివేశా దాఖ్యో వా భ్రజతి నహి యత్కాపి సమయః భజే శ్వేతద్వీపం తమహమిహ గోలోకమితియం విదంతస్తే సంత క్షితి విరాల చారా కటిపయే
శ్రీమత్పయోనిధికేతన చక్రపాణే భోగీంద్ర భోగమణి రంజిత పుణ్యమూర్తే యోగీశ శాశ్వత శరణ్య భవాప్తి భూత శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం బ్రహ్మేంద్ర రుద్ర మరుత కిరీట కోటి సంగట్టితాంగ్రి కమలామల వినోద లక్ష్మీ లసత్కుచ సరోరుహ రాజహంస శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం సంసార ఘోర గహనీచర తో మురార లక్ష్మీనృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార కూపమతి ఘోర మగాధ మూలం, సంప్రాప్య దుఃఖ శత సర్ప సమాకులస్య దీనస్య దేవ కృపయా పదమాగతస్య. శ్రీ లక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార సాగర విశాల కరాళకార నగ్రగ్రహ క్రసన నిగ్రహ విగ్రహస్య వ్యగ్రస్య రాగరస నోమిని పీడితస్య. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార వృక్షమఘ బీజమనంత కర్మ శాకాశతం కరణ పత్రమనంగ పుష్పం ఆరుహ్య దుఃఖ ఫలితం పటతో దయాళో. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార సర్ప గణ వక్త భయోగ్ర తీవ్ర దంష్ట్రాకరాళ విషధక్త వినష్ట మూర్తే నాగారి వాహన సుధాబ్ధి నివాస శౌరే. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార దావదహనాతుర భీకరోరు జ్వాలాబలి విరతి తగ్గత తనూరుహస్య త్వత్పాద పద్మసరసీ శరణాగతస్య. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార జాల పతితస్య జగన్నివాస సర్వేంద్రియార్థ బడిశార్ధ జశోపమస్య ప్రోత్కండిత ప్రచురతాలుకమస్య తస్య. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. సంసార భీకర కరీంద్ర కరాభిఘాత నిష్పిష్టమర్ప పశు సకలార్తినాశ ప్రాణ ప్రయాణ భవ భీతి సమాకులస్య. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. అంధస్య మేహృత వివేక మహాదనస్య చోరై ప్రభో బలి విరింద్రియ నామ దేహై మోహాంధ కూప కుహరే వినిపాతితస్య. శ్రీలక్ష్మీ నృసింహ మమ దేహి కరావలంబం. లక్ష్మీపతే కమలనాభ సురేశ విష్ణో వైకుంఠ కృష్ణ మధుసూదన పుష్కరాక్ష బ్రహ్మణ్య కేశవ జనార్దన వాసుదేవ దేవేశ దేహి కృపణస్య కరావలంబం. యన్మాయయోర్జిత వపు ప్రచుర ప్రవాహ మగ్నాతమత్త నివరోరుహగరావలంబం. లక్ష్మీ నృసింహ చరణాబ్జ మధుప్రతేన స్తోత్రం కృతం సుఖకరం భువి శంకరేణ. శ్రీ లక్ష్మీ నృసింహ కవచం కరావలంబ స్తోత్రం సమాప్తం.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna, Hare
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare.
अग्निले प्रोदितं यक्षस्य देवं दिव्यं होतारं रत्नदातमं हरिः ओम् ओम् ईशेतो जेष्वा वायवस्तो वायवस्ता देवो वा सविदा प्राव्यश्रेष्ठा तमाय कर्मणा हरिः ओम् ओम् अग्नाग्निविदये गृह्णाणो हव्यदादये निहोता सच्चिवर्हसिः हरिः ओम् ओम् सन्नो देवीरविष्टाय आभोभवन्ति भीतये सम्यश्रवण्टिनः हरिः ओम् ॐ पूर्णमद पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्छते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः तच्चं यो राणीमहे कादुं यज्ञाय कादुं यज्ञपदे दैवी स्वस्रस्नः स्वस्यमाण्येभ्यः उद्भण्डिकादिवेशयं सन्नोऽस्तु देवदे सञ्जदुष्पदे ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः सगणावपदु सगणोपुणक्त् सगवीर्यं करवावहे तेजस्विनादीदमस्तु मा विद्विषावहे ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ यो वां पुष्पं वेद पुष्पवान् प्रजावान् वसमान् भवति चन्द्रमा वामवां पुष्पं पुष्पवान् प्रजावान् वसमान् भवति य एवं वेद यो वामायतनं वेद आयतनवान् भवति ॐ तद्विष्णो परमं पदं सदा पश्यन्ति शूलेः दिलिशत्रुराधनं तद्विप्राशोऽभिमन्यवो जाग्रवाक्यं सत्यमिन्द्रिते विष्णो यत्परमं पदम्
And he's in fact conducted a book distribution seminar here. This is our second time having Prabhu here for our Sunday class, and we look forward to having him here many more times. And we'd like to join everyone in welcoming Anuttama Prabhu.
Scarborough for having me here. It's my second time giving class, and it's a wonderful occasion on Narasingha's appearance day. So I hope the Abhishek was so wonderful and mystical and amazing and spiritual. So it's really great to be part of this, and I'm just here to give a class from Srimad Bhagavatam, because I can't really give any realizations of my own except from what the acharyas are. And Sukha is like a parrot, and we just have to repeat after the acharyas and made this so simple to the Prabhupada. So today is a special class. So usually we have more introductory classes on Sundays, but we'll go a little bit about Lord Narasingadev and still make it general enough that everybody can understand. So before I begin, can everybody hear me in the back? Okay, perfect. And is anybody here for the first time or not familiar with Krishna conscious philosophy very much? Okay, thank you for coming here. So I'll make sure that Kayla make my class so that you're able to understand and everyone else as well. So, since the Srimad Bhagavatam, if you can repeat some mantras after me prior to reading the Bhagavatam, that would be great. So if you can join your palms together and repeat after me. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 Narayanam Namaskritya.
Narayanam Namaskritya.
Naram Cheva Narottamam.
Naram Cheva Narottamam.
Devim Saraswati Vyasam.
Devim Saraswati Vyasam.
Mato Jai Mudiriye.
Mato Jai Mudiriye.
Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu.
Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu.
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya.
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya.
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke.
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke.
Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki.
Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki.
So, those are some mantras that are chanted prior to reading Srimad Bhagavatam. So my name is Anuttama Das, and we'll have some time for question and answers in the end. I'll try to make as short and succinct of our class as possible. I've also undergone some training in ISKCON with the GBC College, and part of which was how spiritual movements can be successful in this day and age. And the first sort of rule for that is making sure that you make your presentation of spirituality conducive in the places where you're trying to administer them. So we see Srila Prabhupada, he distributed cookies to a lot of children in temples and whenever he visited. And we obviously see cookies is not really a traditional prasadam in South Indian temples or in Vrindavan or anything, but Srila Prabhupada adjusted because he's a cutting edge guru who presented the parampara and tradition of Krishna consciousness at the same time not adulterating it, but presenting it in a way that's, you know, presentable for all. So one of those ways is we chant the English translation. So the English translation for the prayers we just chanted, the first one, being an alphabet of respectful obeisances under the Supreme Personality of God in Vasudeva. The second mantra's meaning is, prior to opening or reading the Srimad Bhagavatam, I first offer my obeisances unto Srimad Narayana, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, unto Nara Narayana Rishi, the supremest human being, unto the goddess of learning, which is Saraswati, and unto Srila Vyasadeva, who is the author of the Srimad Bhagavatam, author of, you know, all the Upanishads, the divider of the four Vedas, who is, you know, Lord Vishnu himself, and also the author of Srimad Bhagavatam. And then the third mantra's meaning is, by regularly attending classes in the Srimad Bhagavatam and rendering service unto the pure devotee, all that is, you know, within the heart is completely cleansed, and thereby loving devotional service unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead is established as an irrevocable fact. So those are the translations. It's really important to know, while we chant the Sanskrit, it's good to also show the English meaning, so that, especially those of you who are new, it's really meaningful. Okay, so we'll begin with reading Srimad Bhagavatam, and instead of, we'll go into Lord Narasingha's pastimes. So essentially I'll cover four topics today. The first one is, you know, Prahlad Maharaj's teachings, and then Hiranyakashipu's torment, and Lord Narasingadev's appearance, and then Prahlad Maharaj's example. So four different topics I want to touch on. And I have the Srimad Bhagavatam here. So the Srimad Bhagavatam, for those of you who don't know, is the topmost Purana. It is, you know, it's like nectar, is how I would describe it. It's the reason why I'm sitting here in Krishna consciousness is because of Srimad Bhagavatam. I first came across Srimad Bhagavatam in a used bookstore, and I just kind of fell in love with the Srimad Bhagavatam. It was just so magical for me, trying to find out the purpose of life. So the Srimad Bhagavatam is a consists of 12 cantos. It describes the narration of Lord Krishna and his incarnations, as Lord Narasingha did. So the 7th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam is what I have here today. And it also, you know, predicts Lord Buddha's birth. It was written 5,000 years ago. All the different incarnations are described. So the Srimad Bhagavatam is glorious. It's not different from Krishna. You know, Krishna, you see the threefold bending form, and you see Krishna's, you know, the first two cantos are described as Krishna's feet. Then the next two cantos are his, you know, thighs. And then the fifth canto is his navel. The sixth canto is his chest. The seventh and eighth canto is his arms. The ninth canto is his throat. The tenth canto is his lotus face. The 11th canto is his forehead. And the 12th canto is his crown. So that's Krishna's full body. So if you worship Srimad Bhagavatam, which is Krishna in the form of a book, especially in our Kali Yuga, we will make our lives very successful. So therefore, if you don't have a set of Srimad Bhagavatam at home, please consider taking a set of Srimad Bhagavatam. As you can see on the book stand there, above the mridangas, you have the sets of Srimad Bhagavatam displayed, and they're very much meant for your benefit, and we can talk a little bit about that later. So first we'll go into Prahlad Maharaj. So Prahlad Maharaj is the, you know, son of Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu had a very, you know, aversion towards worshipping Lord Vishnu, whereas Prahlad Maharaj turned out to be very different. So let's go into Prahlad Maharaj's pastimes, reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam. Just some excerpts. So, reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Chapter 5. So, this is, one of those famous verses that we bhakti yogis are very much attached to, where it says, Shri Prahlada Vacha, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishno, Smaranam Pavasevanam, Archanam Vandanam Dasyam, Sakyam Atma Nivedanam, Iti Pumsa Pita Vishno, Bhaktes Chenneva Lakshana, Kriyatena Bhagavati Adda, Tanma Devi Tamuttamam. So the first verse, which is 23, goes about the 9 limbs of Bhakti Yoga. So the 9 limbs of Bhakti Yoga are beginning with Shravanam and Kirtanam, which are the most, like the two foundations of Bhakti, is concentrated hearing and concentrated chanting, which we did today with the hearing and chanting of the holy name of Lord Krishna, which is very, very purifying and sanctifying, in the topmost of Maha Mantra, which is the king of all mantras. So here we understand the translation, of course. Prahlad Maharaj said, hearing and chanting about the transcendental holy name, form, qualities, paraphernalia, and pastimes of Lord Vishnu, remembering them, serving the lotus feet of the Lord, offering respectful worship with 16 types of paraphernalia, offering prayers to the Lord, becoming his servant, considering the Lord as one's best friend, and surrendering everything unto him. In other words, serving him with the body, mind, and words. These 9 processes are accepted as pure devotional service. One who has dedicated his or her life to the service of Lord Krishna through these 9 methods should be understood to be the most learned person, for he has acquired complete knowledge. So here we can see that Prahlad Maharaj, Hiranyakashipu, who is the father, who is inimical to Lord Vishnu and is considered an asura, or a person of a demoniac nature, asked Prahlad, what did you learn? What did you teach to your students? And Prahlad says, I'm just serving the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu, hearing and chanting. So based on this, Hiranyakashipu became very, very upset, because he didn't want his son to learn all this. He wanted his son to just become more powerful, materially opulent, learn kind of the ritualistic aspect of the Vedas and just use it for one's own self-gain. And here you have Prahlad, who's a little boy, and he's just offering prayers to Lord Vishnu. So it's very, 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 very exalted devotee. So that's why we see that, Prahlad, Allah, the dying. So it's very dear to Prahlad, and Prahlad Maharaj could really pacify Lord Narsingadev. And Lord Narsingadev, as you can see here, is tearing apart the body of Hiranyakashipu. But Prahlad Maharaj could pacify him, offering him a garland and so forth. So that's Prahlad Maharaj. Through complete surrender unto Lord Narsingadev, Prahlad Maharaj is the topmost devotee of Lord Narsingadev. And we can see that because he was able to pacify him, which even Goddess Lakshmi could not. So that's just another level of devotion. So when we witnessed the Abhishek, so that is Archana, we're offering flowers and Abhishek, different paraphernalia for worship. So that is part of bhakti, as well as the Shravanam and Kirtanam, the chanting of the mantras, the Hare Krishna mantra, and listening. These are all part, remembering, Smaranam. So these are all really, really important angas or limbs of bhakti. It's really important to incorporate that. However, we find that when we are trying to follow the process of bhakti, there can be different obstacles that come by in our life. Can people attest to that? Do they have challenges while they chant? Or okay, some of you? Okay, that's good. So yeah, we see some of that. So in Kali Yuga, we don't see, big, learned Brahmins. Neither do we see the big demons. In Kali Yuga, everything's kind of getting smaller and smaller. Human life is getting shorter, memory is getting shorter, the quality of food is going down, so forth. So similarly, the demons, we may think, Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, all these different personalities. But in Kali Yuga, we have to also think of it as, there's a lot of demons in our mind. The mind wants to distract us away from Krishna, right? So we have to think about, how do we overcome all those negativities? And even though we may not be facing a personality like Hiranyakashipu, we do have different type of distractions. Even though they may not be the big demon with the fangs and all that, we still recognize that there are things that take us away from Krishna, and we have to realize that those are not divine in nature. They're the opposite of divine, which is demoniac. So, but Hiranyakashipu, since this took place in many ages ago, he tormented Prahlad, which is, you could say that's, it was such a cruel thing to do, because Prahlad is just a little boy, and Hiranyakashipu was just so inimical to him. So so Hiranyakashipu's torments will be the next thing I want to share, which is in this 7th canto in chapter 5, where Prahlad Maharaj spoke in this way, and Hiranyakashipu became so angry that he just threw him off the lap, and he just became very silent. So here the translation mentions that Indignant and angry, his reddish eyes like molten copper, Hiranyakashipu said to his servants, "O demons, take this boy away from me. He deserves to be killed. Kill him as soon as possible." So you can understand how, as a parent, you know, saying that to your own child, this is the nature of Hiranyakashipu. He just wanted to become the most powerful. He actually wanted to become the supreme lord of the universe by gaining all these penances, you know, praying to Lord Brahma, standing on one foot, and basically having like an anthill cover his body, because he was offering such great penances that it trembled the whole universe. So here we see Hiranyakashipu is putting this type of, you know, difficulties onto Prahlad. And Prahlad was really able to overcome them because he was completely surrendered, Atma Nivedana, completely surrendered unto the Supreme Lord. So that's the glories of Prahlad Maharaj. Despite all the difficulties he faced, he was able to overcome them because he was just a pure devotee of Lord Vishnu, Lord Krishna. So we can see that from this example, when we come across different difficulties in life, we just rely and surrender on the Supreme Lord. Because difficulty will be there, because as Krishna mentions, this world is full of sorrow, dukkhalyam, ashashvatam. And he also, and all, Krishna also mentions, the world is full of birth, death, old age, and disease, janma, mrityu, jara, vyadi. You know, so these four, you know, aspects of the universe is there, and how do we overcome them, how do we remain steady through them? It's through the process of bhakti and ultimate, you know, sharanagati, or also known as sharanagati. So, you know, the translation further goes, this boy Prahlada is the killer of my brother, for he has given up his family to engage in devotional service of the enemy, Lord Vishnu, like a menial servant. So here we can see Hiranyakashipu is putting forth arguments to his servants, saying that this is what, you know, Prahlad Maharaj has done. So we clearly understand that those who worship Lord Vishnu are considered to be very, very divine, and we must always strive for worshipping and engaging in that type of service to be the topmost of topmost yogi, which is a bhakti yogi. Not a karma yogi, jnana yogi, ashtanga yogi, but the topmost is to be a bhakti yogi. So we understand from Prahlad Maharaj's example that, you know, despite putting some torturous torments, he was able to overcome them. And just to you know, just to give you an example, so Prahlad Maharaj, only being 5 years old, his young age, he had this affectionate relationship with father and mother, but he eventually departed from that because he wanted to ultimately surrender to Lord Vishnu. And as a child, you'll be very affectionate to your parents, but here, Prahlad Maharaj at a very young age knew, you know, what's the purpose of life, who am I, and what needs to be done, and he did it. So that's something that's extremely, extremely admirable as us aspiring, you know, servants of the Lord. We have to take examples like this from the Srimad Bhagavatam, such as from Prahlad Maharaj. Because there, you know, you can have teachings, but then the example to show how those teachings are practically displayed, that is the Srimad Bhagavatam. The Bhagavad Gita tells you the purpose of life, how to live. The Srimad Bhagavatam prepares you for the time of departure or the time of death from this world, because it began with a conversation between, you know, Sukadeva Goswami, who is Srila Vyasadeva, the author's son, and Parikshit, was a great king who renounced everything. He had 7 days to live. He wondered, what's the purpose of life? What do I need to do? You know, how do I prepare for death? So the Srimad Bhagavatam prepares you for that. So the Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, you have your Bhagavad Gita as your, you know, foundational study, and then the Srimad Bhagavatam just goes deeper and deeper into bhakti yoga. So here we can see that all the torments that were engaged, they were very, very extreme to experience for Prahlad, but Prahlad was able to overcome them. So the Rakshasas, which are the demons, servants of Hiranyakashipu, began striking the tender parts of Prahlad Maharaj's body with their tridents. They had fearful faces, sharp teeth, reddish, coppery beards and hair. They appeared extremely threatening, making a tumultuous sound, shouting, "Chop him up, pierce him." They began striking Prahlad Maharaj, who sat silently, meditating on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is something that is impossible for anyone else to do. Prahlad Maharaj, despite being struck and, you know, abused, he was silently there meditating. And just by that meditation and Shraddha, which is firm faith, he was such an exalted devotee because of this. And we can learn so much from Prahlad Maharaj's example. And by doing so, Prahlad Maharaj, you know, was able to overcome this despite all these plots to put him in a, you know, a pit of snakes, you know, hit him, things like that. So we want to make sure that, you know, we understand that, you know, when whatever difficulties we go through is nothing compared to what Hiranyakashipu tormented Prahlad with. So, you know, we have to take that into consideration in our lives and also think, okay, how can we surrender unto the Supreme Lord in however way possible? It's good to take steps in bhakti, not to just jump and then, you know, relinquish our bhakti practice. We start, you know, start low, go slow, and we begin with our chanting. We begin with, you know, reading about the Lord, just absorbing ourselves in Krishna consciousness. And slowly we should try and develop and see, where was I 6 months ago? Where am I going to go 6 months from now? Am I developing in bhakti? Is my chanting getting better? Is my reading getting better? Is my understanding of applying Krishna consciousness in the world getting better? It's always good to think about that. Otherwise, we just become stagnant and we just kind of go down. So those are things that we need to always be wary of. So okay, so that's enough of Hiranyakashipu. So we'll go to Lord Narsingadev. So the uniqueness about Lord Narsingadev is we chant, ito narsimha parato narsimho yato yato yami man bahir narsimho vilayi. So bahir narsimho, so Narsingha is outside, hridaya narsimho, Narsingha is inside. And wherever I go, I see Lord Narsingha there, right? So that is Prahlad Maharaja's vision, because he has a spiritual vision, not the material vision. So he sees Lord Narsingadev everywhere. Whereas Hiranyakashipu doesn't see Lord Narsingadev. He says, oh, where is this Lord Narsingadev? So we'll go into Lord Narsingadev's appearance. And that's at a later chapter. And I want to stick to Shastra as much as possible so that... So here we understand Lord Narsingadev. So Hiranyakashipu has a conversation with Prahlad, mentioning that, oh, most unfortunate Prahlad, imagine that. You have always described a supreme being other than me, because again, Hiranyakashipu thinks I am the Lord of the universe. A supreme being who is above everything. He is the controller of everyone and who is all pervading. But where is he? If he is everywhere, just as, you know, he has a vision, Prahlad Maharaj, then why is he not present before me in this pillar? And then the following verse says, because you are speaking so much nonsense, I shall now sever your head from the body. Now let me see your most worshipable God come to protect you. I want to see it. So, being obsessed with anger, Hiranyakashipu, who was very great in bodily strength, thus chastised his exalted devotee son Prahlada with his harsh words, cursing him again and again. Hiranyakashipu took his sword, got up from his royal throne, and with great anger struck the fist against the column. Then from within the pillar came a fearful sound, which appeared to crack the covering of the universe. Oh my dear Yudhishthira, the sound even reached to the abodes of the demigods like Lord Brahma. And when the demigods heard it, they thought, oh no, our planets are now being destroyed. While showing his extraordinary prowess, Hiranyakashipu, who desired to kill his own son, heard that wonderful tumultuous sound which had never been heard. Upon hearing the sound, other leaders of the world became afraid. None of them could find the origin of the sound in the assembly. And then we have the appearance of Lord Narsingadev. So the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is present within the pillar of the assembly hall, exhibited a wonderful form never before seen. The form was that of a man, not of a man, nor a lion. Thus the Lord appeared in his wonderful form in the assembly hall. While Hiranyakashipu looked around to look for the source of the sound, that wonderful form of the Lord, which could not be ascertained but to be either man or lion, emerged from the pillar. In amazement, Hiranyakashipu could wonder, what is the creature that is half man and half lion? So Hiranyakashipu studied the form of the Lord, trying to decide who was the form of Narasimha Deva standing before them. The Lord's form was extremely fearsome because of his angry eyes, which resembled molten gold. His shining mane, which expanded the dimensions of his fearful face. His deadly teeth, his razor-sharp tongue, which moved about like a dueling sword. His ears were erect and motionless, and his nostrils appeared gaping mouth, appeared like caves on a mountain. His jaws parted fearfully, and his entire body touched the sky. His neck was very short and thick, his chest broad, his waist thin, and the hairs on his body as white as the rays of the moon. His arms, which resembled flanks of soldiers, spread in all directions as he killed the demons, rogues and atheists with his conch shell, disc, club, lotus, and other natural weapons. So that is the form of Lord Narasimhadev appearing from a pillar. And the prelude to that is Prahlad Maharaj, because he's meditating upon the Lord all the time, he sees the Lord everywhere. The Lord is present everywhere, but because he is so devoted, he is completely absorbed in the spiritual energy, he is able to see the Lord everywhere. But Hiranyakashipu was not privy to that. And when Lord appeared through his yoga maya potency, being visible to Hiranyakashipu was in amazement, because he had this benediction that, you know, I can't be killed outside or inside, you know, neither at, you know, the daylight or at night, you know, so neither on the ground nor on the sky, neither by a beast or a man. So, you know, Lord Vishnu is like, okay, I'll come as this form and you're finished. So that's what Lord Narasimhadev takes care of his devotees. He's very fearful for the demons. So those are very inimical to Lord Narasimhadev. You know, Lord Narasimhadev is very, you know, appears to be very fearful to them. But like Prahlad is, you know, a little boy, and he's so joyful to receive Lord Narasimhadev. And I'd like to end off with a little bit on Prahlad Maharaj's example, which is applicable to us because we all live in big cities. So our founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada mentioned a statement which was, you know, book distribution three times. And he did farm communities. So Srila Prabhupada had this vision where he wanted to share Krishna consciousness, as well as he wanted to establish these communities rurally where we serve the Lord together in a simpler way. So Prahlad Maharaj's teachings that I like to share is, my dear Lord Narasimhadeva, I see that there are many saintly persons indeed, but they are interested in their own deliverance. Not caring for the big cities and towns, they go to the Himalayas or forest to meditate with vows of silence, Maunavrata. They are not interested in delivering others. As for me, however, I do not wish to be liberated alone, leaving aside all these poor fools and rascals. I know that without Krishna consciousness, without taking the shelter of your lotus feet, one cannot be happy. Therefore, I wish to bring them back to the shelter of your lotus feet. So here we understand that Prahlad Maharaj, he didn't want to go to the Himalayas and meditate silently by having this Maunavratam. He wanted to be in the place where there's a lot of people, like the city, and deliver everyone else and expand this knowledge about glories and worship of Lord Vishnu, the process of Bhakti Yoga, the process of Krishna consciousness. So here we see Prahlad Maharaj is so selfless, he doesn't care for my own liberation, but he wants to, everyone else, let's, you know, go towards the Lord together. So that's the magnanimous example of Prahlad Maharaj. And, you know, from this we learn that it's important to save oneself by chanting and honoring prasadam and worship and reading of books and spiritual literatures. And at the same time, it's also important that if there are people around us who are very favorable or very innocent, we can explain to them by sharing this knowledge. So one of the ways is the Bhadra campaign, which is a campaign that goes till September 10th of this year. is sharing of the Srimad Bhagavatam, and it's mentioned in Canto 12, Chapter 12, I believe, verse 13, that those who share or give the Srimad Bhagavatam, either to oneself or to another person, they on this day of Bhadra, which is the 10th of September, and worship it on that day, their assurance to going back to Godhead is assured. So therefore, it's recommended if you have a Srimad Bhagavatam, great, you can gift a Srimad Bhagavatam, and that's one of the ways where you can support the spreading of wisdom. And does anybody like free things? Who you like likes free things? Free stuff? Okay, raise your hand. You've been very honest. Okay. So I have a free offer. I'll do a free offer because I live not too far away, and this is something that I haven't shared with the ISKCON Scarborough devotees. Is if you're new and you don't have a Srimad Bhagavatam set, if you plan to take a Srimad Bhagavatam set and consider it as an investment in your own life, I can come and do a Bhagavatam installation at your home. Yeah, so Bhagavatam installation is a half an hour ceremony involving worship of the Srimad Bhagavatam and reading the preface that Srila Prabhupada very much wanted us to have. Srila Prabhupada brought the Srimad Bhagavatam on the Jaladuta with him, and he had the first three candles, and he painstakingly translated this with all the commentaries of the acharyas. And this set of Srimad Bhagavatam, considered as a life investment, because, you know, we spend $150 on gas. If you want to go to India, we don't think about spending $1,000 on pilgrimage trips. But for the Srimad Bhagavatam, we should try and have a set of Srimad Bhagavatam at home. And it says that when the Srimad Bhagavatam is home, the vibration of the home changes, and all the different devatas or the demigods are there present, showering their blessings. So we should take the Srimad Bhagavatam, and the second important thing is also read the Srimad Bhagavatam. So that's something that I always advocate, is not just keep the book, wrap it in, you know, red cloth and keep it on the shelf and it's collecting dust. Make sure you read the Srimad Bhagavatam and worship the Srimad Bhagavatam. So I will end my talk there. We have about 5 minutes. Is there any questions, comments, or protests? Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Prahlad Maharaj was born in a demonic family.
Yes.
His association was all demons. His parents were demons.
Yeah.
The gurus who were sent to him were propagating demonic activities.
Yeah.
Excepting for the fact that he was in the womb of Kayadu, when Narada Muni gave some instruction. He had no direct interaction with any devotee nor he didn't come across any scriptures. How do you develop unflinching faith on the Lord?
Your question has the answer. So in the womb, you know, Prahlad Maharaj is being instructed, and even there's a pure devotee who's instructing Prahlad Maharaj within the womb, that is enough association for that particular, you know, entity, soul, to be completely, perfectly Krishna conscious. Similarly, you know, we see that when Sukadeva Goswami was within the womb, he already knew the whole Srimad Bhagavatam. And you know, these are things that we can't conceive of, but it is actually very, very powerful when you have a pure devotee or the Lord who says, even with Parikshit, Parikshit was in the womb of Uttara, and the Brahmastra was being thrown at Uttara, and Uttara was praying, Pahi Pahi Maha Yogin Devi Devi Jagatpade Ganyantavavyam Yasya Matrapityu Parasparam. So Pahi Pahi, so please save me, great yogi. So it prays and the Lord saves him, and Parikshit is a great recipient of this knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam from Sukadeva Goswami's, you know, lotus lips. So it's possible when you have association of a pure devotee like Narad Muni, when you have the association of the Lord himself. The Prahlad Maharaj was like that, and you're right, when Prahlad Maharaj's association was not very good. Yes.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Okay, when we have a connection with such a pure devotee and the Supreme Lord, it's possible. How is it possible in Kali Yuga, with the present circumstances and situations given to us, how can we become purely Krishna conscious or trusted Lord?
Mm-hmm. So that comes by serving devotees. If you have to, you know, surrender unto the spiritual master and consider the order of the spiritual master's one's very own life. And that's the way for because we can't do anything on our own. We can never do anything on our own. And that's why we are indebted to Srila Prabhupada, who came to the Western countries. And this Bhagavatam is not just the verses, it has the Bhakti Vedanta purports, which means the Srila Prabhupada's purports. So Srila Prabhupada is the preeminent Shiksha Guru, the instructing spiritual master of ISKCON, and we associate with Srila Prabhupada when we study the Srimad Bhagavatam, the Bhagavad Gita, and read the purports. Then we can serve the devotees in person. There's so many, you know, veterans in Krishna consciousness who come here, we can serve them. And in this way, we can attain to perfection. If you're a bit short on time.
Hari Bol.
Hari Bol. Do we have last questions?
Yeah.
Last question.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. In this Kali Yuga,
yeah,
we have got Hiranyakashyap, like the Putin is there to destroy the world.
Mm.
So how to change their mind,
yes,
to prevent the world from getting destroyed?
Great question. So our process is very simple, which is Harinama Sankirtana Yajna. When we chant the holy name offenselessly, getting together, we can counteract all these negative energies that are there in Kali Yuga. We raise people's consciousness by involving them into Lord Chaitanya Sankirtan movement. So even though you mentioned Kali Yuga is a very dark time, Lord Chaitanya, we are in the 10,000 years of the golden era of Kali Yuga. So we must engage in the simple process of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu giving us, which is chanting Hare Krishna, distributing prasadam, and distributing knowledge about Krishna, which is, you know, books, wisdom, and absorbing it ourselves. So in this way, we shouldn't be concerned about worldly events, because negativities always exist, which you're very much right, the Hiranyakashipus of the world. But the Sankirtana Yajna is the Yuga Dharma, and that's what we should engage in.
Yeah. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Vedanta Swami Te Namine Thank you.
Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Namaste Narasimhaya.
Namaste Narasimhaya.
Namaste Narasimhaya.
Namaste Narasimhaya.
Thank you.
Please don't be shy.
So we let, like, all of you, once again, can we have the hands up again? Please come forward. We have a little gift for everyone who's here for the first time. Like, welcome you to ISKCON Scarborough and hope to have you back many times.
Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare
Hare, Hare
Krishna. Anybody else? I feel there's a lot of new faces. Don't be shy.
Okay.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
So, today's program would not have been possible without the help of everyone. So we'd first like to thank all the pujaris who did an excellent job of decorating their lordship. As well as the devotees who prepared prasadam, assisted in various other capacities, cleaning paraphernalia and helping to pack the prasadam. There's and obviously cleaning the temple and preparing for this beautiful program. I'd like to thank everybody. And in addition to that, we also have a few devotees who sponsored today's festival. Firstly, we have our flowers are sponsored by Amal Tagore Prabhu and family, as well as Pushma Mataji. And Mother Mangal Das has sponsored today's feast. Today, Abhisheka was sponsored by Dhyanitai Prabhu. We'd also like to welcome Prabhu back. He recently came back from India and Sri Lanka. And
thanks for coming back. We miss you.
And then we would like to thank Bhakti Vinod Prabhu, who is not only instrumental in doing a lot of the behind-the-scenes services, but he has also sponsored today's whole deity outfit. Other sponsors today are Radha Gopinath Prabhu and Yashomati Mataji, who sponsored the fruits. As well as Srimati Mataji, as well as an anonymous devotee who happens to be behind me. Now, it's not only festivals that you can sponsor. So every Sunday we have sponsorship opportunities for our feast as well as the lordship flowers. So if anyone is interested, they can see one of the committee members, whether Dwarka, Dhyanitai Prabhu, or Ganapati Prabhu, and they can give you some more information about that.
Oh,
yes, one more sponsor is Melanie Mataji. So we are very happy. We recently restarted our programs and we're happy to see a good turnout. And we will be continuing with our programs. And we look forward to seeing all of you every week. Now, the next part of our program will be chanting of one round of Mahamantra Japa, which will be led by Padmakshi Mataji. Followed by, we will have prasadam, which is takeout. So, as today is a festival day, we are observing fasting till dusk. For those of you that are observing, the breakfast time is 9:09 p.m. And we have arranged Ekadasi prasadam. But there are also some preparations that are non-Ekadasi. So for those of you who would like to break your fast with Ekadasi prasadam, the items in the plates are Ekadasi. Any of the sweets and stuff that are packed separately are non-Ekadasi. And for those that are observing fasting, the break fast time is dusk, which is 9:09 p.m. So I will hand it over to Padmakshi Mataji to lead us in one round of japa. And I believe the beads have been distributed. If anybody needs beads, little Mataji here is distributing. We'd also like to thank Sati Prabhu. And they're available on YouTube.
And Cindy Maji for her beautiful cake as usual.
Yes, of course.
Yes, beautiful cake.
It has gone.
Thank you.
Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya,
Prabhu Nityananda,
Shri Advaita Gadadhara,
Shri
Vasadika Ravakta Vrinda,
Shri
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama